god. Dude, I forgot to shave again. SMH. Most dudes my age, they can't grow, like, good-looking beards. It's not that I'm not growing the hair. It's that the hair is kind of blonde. So it looks really patchy and fragmented, but I don't really care. I don't care. Yes. I don't care. Alright guys, we gotta get down to brass, alright? We gotta talk about some big serious stuff. We don't have much time to talk about it. What is consciousness? Is consciousness energy? Is it a force? I think consciousness is somewhat of a force. Is it gravity? Is it consciousness? What is it all but the super combination of all the forces combined to create a thinking entity named, subscriber name here, to explore the universe? It's ingenious, really. I mean, who invented these things? We can't even say who actually did invent these things other than God. That's fine. You know, I like the God theory. I believe in God. What if that's what you do when you're a species, space-faring species with nobody else to space-fare with? Is you just go visit life-faring planets and you just take the best species and optimize it until it thinks and can, like, communicate with you on a higher level. That's what basically aliens would do. This is why it makes no sense, like, with veganism and farming animals and all these things. We're not, like, treating animals the best way we could be. Instead of creating friends, creating cognizant, conscious friends, and expediting the evolutionary advantage that they have over the other animals, instead we farm them, we just kill them and eat them. On a universal scale, it makes absolutely no sense. But, so this is the container for that thing, is the planet, Mother Earth, and nature. The laws of nature are what contains humanity to this planet, what we are tethered to. Once we leave this planet, it will be universal laws, or stuff like that, space laws. Then the entities that keep that in check could be higher dimensional beings. So there are checks of intelligence, checks of life forms that already exist, so we don't really have to worry about being mistreated by aliens that want to just consume us, because it wouldn't make any sense. When you have all the ideas of unity in place with the species, then when they leave the planet, they go looking for other entities who have the same ideals and principles of unification in mind. So basically what I'm trying to say is veganism, ultra strong, it is the way of the universe, all right? But if you're not already sold on that idea, maybe I sell you a little bit more. If you consume entropy, suffering, and all these things, you're gonna have a worse time. That's why I say, like, you're not going vegan because it's cool and it looks good to do, because it doesn't. The social climate, never adhere to the social climate, never ever. The people who adhere to the social climate aren't happy. Generally speaking, they're not making decisions that are good for them. They're just good for the idea that other people think are good for them, which is not actually good for them. So you always do what's good for you. Basically, the key principle of being vegan, which is so important, is the reduction in consumption of entropic energy. Whenever you have animals that are suffering, or any organism that is suffering, and then you, like, eat that, like, what does that make any sense? That is the energy. That is what you repurpose into energy, is suffering. That is, like, the darkness of humanity is really, when it comes down to it, is diet and consumption. There's arguably other things such as corruption, all these things, but corruption and stuff like that doesn't go unchecked. You don't really have to worry about anything. You just keep chugging along and do your best. When I mean it ends here, I mean it ends here. You got nuclear war. You always got nuclear war, some big weapon that's just gonna kill everybody, but somebody is going to survive, or the DNA of humanity will survive. They'll be resurrected by aliens or some cosmic principle that just aligns them into the primordial ooze once again. Essentially what it means is maybe people survive in bunkers, whatever. Nuclear war is not the end of humanity. What is the end of everything humanity is a black hole, a complete repurpose of the energy. So what that means is, essentially, when you have black holes, you have a super condensed point of energy that potentially, in theory, rips through space-time into another point. So you got this hourglass go like a wormhole, shooting the energy and mass and all the crap that it sucks in into some other part of the universe. But there's this other idea. What if it just is this infinitely dense vector of energy? So when you have that theory, and you have the theories of galaxies, at the center of each galaxy is a supermassive black hole, these are what I consider safeguards for organisms that produce more entropy in the universe. So essentially, like, this is the ultra safeguard for the universe is a black hole system. If there's enough entropy in the universe that overruns the system, black holes would be there to reboot it. You can turn pretty much anything into a black hole with enough energy, like a peanut, but you wouldn't be able to turn it into a black hole with all the energy that we have on Earth. So let's start with basic math, right? We got the number zero. What is the number zero? Well, it's nothing, right? The number zero is nothing. In terms of quantifying, number zero means to have nothing of. I have nothing of this, right? But if you view zero based on mathematics as a value system, you get something quite interesting. So let's say you have one, negative one. These two both add to create a smiley face, but also to create the value of zero. The value of zero is then negative one and one at the same time, right? It is both these values as well as the value zero to represent both negative one and one being added. So you could do that with negative two and positive two based on the value system structure. Then zero is negative one and negative two and one and two at the same time. The value of zero has just increased. So the more numbers we add, the more zero's value increases until it is infinite. So we get infinite value. That's kind of weird. Infinite positives and negatives. And you could say that for just about every number on the mathematical plane. So that's when you view zero and numerical terms based on value systems. Now, the interesting thing is when you apply value systems to things in the environment and base it purely on mathematics, I think the best example, clout economy, which is interesting, is like the psychological ties people have to that based on the value system it creates through mathematics, and money. Because once you start attributing numerical value to yourself, you're always going to want more. And that's the secret, is to look past value structures like this, or quantifications disguised as value structures, because really the value of things is infinite. Now you might be thinking, well, okay, so what is the value of this spring hook? I mean, it can't do anything. I mean, you could probably make it into something. But yeah, that's kind of the point. You could, it's so many possibilities. I mean, you could use it to save someone's life. I mean, say I did that. Say I saved your life with this spring hook. And then you went on to save the entire human race. But to quantify the spring hook, you could just say, yeah, I have one spring hook. So where mathematics should really solely lies in quantification in order to do things, right? In order to put things together, to engineer, that is where math is at its strongest. Math as a value system is not a good idea because of all the reasons I've just described. Basically, it's a reduction of your value. The point is value systems, all right? Zero has infinite value. So let's look at the cycle of a universe. Whew. I've seen this depiction a lot, and I really, really like it, because what this is showing you is the birth and death of a universe. So here's the dying part of the universe, sort of in an hourglass. So where it all condenses into this point, this region, I'll call this zero. This is point zero. That is everything in the universe. Everything that makes up the universe is condensed into this singular point, the singularity that then, boom, explodes into Big Bang. When there is nothing in the universe, when the universe is nothing, there is actually infinite things within that point. What this means is there can never actually be nothing. There can be maybe less of a quantity of something, but maybe that's in the environment, maybe it doesn't exist yet, the quantity of the thing doesn't exist, maybe it exists in the future, maybe it's just an alternate dimension. So even quantifications don't really work, but to be sensible, you need to sort of ground yourself and that's one way of doing it. So that's like the Big Bang theory. So this got me thinking, well, what does this mean in terms of black holes? Black holes, you know, they consume. We got a black hole, boom, into a singularity, a singular point in which the all the energy, the mass, matter, all of it just shoots down into this area. So say it doesn't turn into a wormhole. Say this is not the theory we're abiding by. Say there were multiple black holes, like tornadoes of black holes that all combined, and all of the singularities combined to create an infinitely dense point of space-time that then exploded outwards to create maybe the universe, a segment of the universe. If you were able to consume the entire universe in black holes, basically this is the singularity point of all the black holes combined, and then the energy shoots back out. So this also kind of looks like wormhole theory. The black hole consumes and then puts it back out. So the cycle of the universe could be dictated by black holes. But say this is what happened to create the universe, that is the implication that entropy over on the system. So what you got to do in order to reverse entropy, which is really the most important part, is view black holes as consumption. All right, this is consumption. You can reflect a variety of factors of daily human living as consumption. This is the most penultimate form of consumption, is a black hole vector, all right? So what this is telling you is you don't want this to happen again. We don't want this to happen again. Even when we die, if our conscious energy carries on as like ghosts or spiritual energy, it goes somewhere, right? There's a lot to be accounted for, stuff like that I'm not going to get into, but the point is you don't want this to happen again. What you want is a continuation of what is currently happening, which is the ever-expanding universe. Say you did want to restart everything. You wanted to reboot the entire universe. You basically do this thing. You'd create black holes that would consume the entirety of the observable universe and basically repurpose it like this. So you repurpose the entropic existence of everything into something that can maybe try again. So it's like a fail-safe. I like to call it a reboot, but using sort of technological terms is kind of fringe to me, because it runs into simulation theory. I think simulation theory is interesting as long as you're not reducing your reality to like basic things, and you're, because that's the problem with simulation theory, is you're reducing mathematics and the human behavior to like observable patterns and stuff like that. You don't want to do that. You don't want to reduce things ever. You want to grow the complexity, right? Like the universe expanding. That's what you want to do. So how do we stop all this entropy? You probably want to know, well, what do you got to do? It's so easy. And it's not lame to do this. It's good. It's good to be nice to people. You have to be nice. But the most important thing is to put out a lot of this. All right. Lots of love. I know it's like, I don't even get preachy. I don't want to sound like weird, because this is actually like how you would counteract entropy, is to just be your best self and treat everything with care around you, so that people will treat you with care and they won't have a problem with you. You'd be like the coolest guy ever. So that's all you gotta do. Like, you gotta show the love, be a loving person, and don't be ashamed. Do not be ashamed. If you say, oh, I love Funko Pops, dude, cool, dude. Tell me, like, what's your favorite? Don't be reduced. All right, you got balls, show it. That's all you gotta do. And don't, the problem is like, even if like your ideology is to, yeah, let's mess it all up, let's get to this. This would take probably billions of years to even accomplish. So say, yeah, let's start messing up right now. Die, become a ghost, try and like mess things up for other people so they die and become a ghost. The problem you have is this would take billions of years and it would be fruitless because it restarts. So it's basically you have to keep starting over and over and over again until you get this right. So that's kind of my final message. It ends here. All right, I said it ends here, but I think really it ends right there. So guys, I think I kind of want to quit YouTube, and you know what? Yeah, I think I need to quit this website, because I don't really know what I'm doing here anymore, and I'm just being honest. it's kind of funny, but it's kind of not so funny at the same time. Let me just end on this note. Bad aliens, all right? Bad aliens don't exist. All right, say bad aliens don't exist because they're contained to planetary laws, like Mother Nature, and then the universe laws, and then everything that's watching them, safeguards and all that stuff. Bad aliens don't exist because humans are lucky. So that means y'all, you guys are lucky. Oh my God. All right, look, I'm sorry. I gotta go, all right?